So I'm going to talk on this unique topic on normal weight obesity. Now, when we talk about obesity, what immediately comes to your mind is that a higher BMI or BMI beyond a certain cutoff or a higher weight, because this is what we have been traditionally trained. Now, when I say normal weight obesity, it looks like an oxymoron. And if you actually look at it, it's a bit confusing. So in the next few minutes of my presentation, I'm going to talk on this concept of normal weight obesity. Now, to understand this concept, what we have to know is that although in the clinical practice, we have been using obesity based on the BMI cutoffs, if you look at the actual definition of obesity, it is defined as an excessive body fat accumulation, which is associated with clear risk to health. I agree that BMI has been the simplest and the well-studied so far, and it's also very practical. At least we are using it, we are measuring the weight which is adjusted for the height. But then it has several limitations. Because we are here, we're looking at the weight adjusted for height and not really the body composition. And the body mass index cannot differentiate between the fat mass and the lean mass. And also, although we have epidemiological studies which have clearly shown associations between higher BMI and cardiometabolic risk, we still see that in some of the ethnicities, there's a disproportionately high prevalence of diabetes and cardiovascular disease with the lower BMI. Now, this can be answered by this unique phenotype of normal weight obesity. Now, if you look at the BMI performance to define obesity by, as per the body of adiposity, you can look see that on the right-hand side, the BMI has a poor sensitivity, although it has a good specificity. The sensitivity can range somewhere between 0.2 to 0.28, although the specificity is good. This BMI cutoff value to diagnose adiposity, although has a high specificity, has low sensitivity and may fail to identify half of the people with excess body fat percentages, as per this meta-analysis. And then, of course, are aware of this particular picture. I think I've seen several times in a teaching. So this is the YY paradox. This is Dr. John Yutkin and Dr. Yagnik. I think this was asked as a question earlier. So in this particular picture, they clearly showed that in spite of having a similar BMI, the patient in this picture, Dr. John Yutkin, had a body fat percentage of 9.1% as compared to Dr. Yagnik, who was an Asian Indian, with the body fat as high as 21%, thus suggests showing that in spite of having a similar BMI, you can have a large disparity in body fat. And also this kind of proposed the thin fat Indian concept that in spite of having a low BMI, Asians can have a higher adiposity. Now, this is also shown by several studies. Now, this is one such study which looked at the body composition of different ethnicity. And in this particular study, the first figure you see is the total body fat percentages. A is men and the second B is women. And you can see, and in this particular study, they showed that Asian Indians had the highest total body fat percent in both men and women. And if you look at the lean mass, again, it was lowest. So it was reversed when we're talking about the lean mass. And the same study, when they look at the body fat percent, it was again significantly higher in Asian Indians. And they also looked across the age group and it was seen, interestingly, that across all ethnicity, the visceral fat increased with age. So with these studies, it was shown that there's a definite ethnicity-based differences in the body compositions. And we Asian Indians have more fat, both total and abdominal fat, with less lean mass, skeletal mass, bone mineral than all other ethnic groups. This ethnic differences in body fat distribution, muscularity, and also the body frame and leg length discrepancies may contribute to this ethnic specific relationship between body fatness and BMI. Thus, the BMI cutoffs were revised, which could answer this discrepancy to some extent, but still may not again explain the differences in spite of using a BMI specific ethnicity cutoffs. And then we also have this effect of the limb length and the body frame on the BMI, where you can see that an individual with the short legs, in spite of having a similar body fat, may be labeled as high BMI. And then an individual with a smaller frame, in spite of having a high body fat, may have a similar BMI as an individual with a low body fat and a big frame. Body frame. There are several factors which kind of addresses or kind of clarifies this limitations of BMI. And then you have, when you talk about this adiposity, you have again different types. Important one, you see what you see in A is the visceral fat. What you see in B, in the white is the subcutaneous fat. And then the total of this, that is in both subcutaneous and the visceral adiposity combined together contributes total fat. So when the next few slides, when I talk about total fat, I'm talking about this both visceral and the subcutaneous adipose tissue. And when you're talking about visceral adiposity, we are referring to only this visceral fat. So now let's look at the definition of normal weight obesity. Now this describes phenotypes or individuals who have normal BMI but have increased total adiposity. And then you have a subtype of this normal metabolically obese normal weight, where you're again talking about a normal weight as per the BMI, but then they have higher visceral adiposity and also have clusters of metabolic abnormalities. Now, why is it important to identify these phenotypes? Because these individuals have shown to have a higher degree of metabolic dysfunction, cardiometabolic dysfunctions, and higher mortality as compared to those with normal body fat percentage or lower body fat percent. Now, based on the body fat or the body composition distributions, you have these four specific types of obesity phenotypes described. And it's important that we are aware of these phenotypes. Now, the first phenotype, you have this metabolically healthy obese. So here the obesity is just based on the BMI, but they have a normal visceral or a lower visceral adipose tissue total fat and do not have metabolic abnormalities. And then you have this metabolically obese normal weight, normal BMI, but high visceral adiposity, thus have high risk of metabolic abnormalities. And also metabolically normal obese is something similar, but we're talking about a normal BMI with a higher fat mass. Now these patients may not have metabolic abnormalities, but are at high risk of metabolic abnormalities. And some of these also include metabolically obese normal weight. And then you have the worst form of which is a sarcopenic obesity, which is very obvious in our patients, for patients who have high BMI, high visceral fat, low lean mass, low cardiorespiratory fitness, and have metabolic abnormalities, and thus have a high cardiovascular mortality. Now, the prevalence of normal weight obesity is not really well established. And if you look at the studies which are available, there's a wide variability. Now, this could be because of the ethnicity space differences in the body composition, but it's also secondary to the differences in the methods used to assess body composition and also because of the different cutoff points used. I'll present a few of these studies to know what's the prevalence. So this is a Korean study which showed the prevalence of normal weight obesity of around 36% men and 20% women, so around one third of the on the subject study. Whereas in China, the prevalence reported was 9.5% for men and 6% is women. Of course, there's a difference in the methodology. And this is a study from India, from Dr. Nitin Kapoor, Nihal Thomaser, and the other groups from Kerala Diabetes Prevention Program, where the prevalence of normal weight obesity was 32%, again, attributing to one third of the population studied. And this is another study which I did when I was in Vellore. So in this particular study, we looked at visceral adiposity. And based on this, we defined metabolically obese normal weight. And prevalence was 19% in postmenopausal women and 9% in premenopausal women. So these are individuals who also had high cardiometabolic risk factors. Now, it's important to be aware of this phenotypes because these have been associated with cardiometabolic disease. They have shown to be an inflammatory state, have high insulin resistance, dyslipidemia, which increase the risk of cardiometabolic disease. And also, they can have direct effect on the myocardium, causing systolic and diastolic dysfunction and can be independent risk factor for cardiovascular mortality. When we talk about obesity, this concept of metabolically healthy obese and metabolically unhealthy obesity stems from the pathophysiology where the adipose tissue can behave differently. In metabolically unhealthy obesity, basically there's a hypertrophy of the adipocytes rather than hyperplasia in the subcutaneous adipose tissue, and there's limitation of expansion in the subcutaneous adipose tissue, and there's an ectopic fat distribution in the liver, muscle, and fat leading to insulin resistance and other cardiovascular risk factors. Now, these patients also kind of have higher inflammatory markers. So like I said earlier, when the calorie excess, the adipose tissue can behave differently. In a healthy expansion, there's hyperplasia of adipocytes, and this is not associated with insulin resistance or inflammation. On the contrary, in the unhealthy expansion, there's basically hypertrophy, and then there's hypertrophy of the adipocytes, and the low-grade inflammation and macrophage infiltration, hence it's considered a low-grade inflammatory state, and ectopic lipid deposition can lead to lipotoxicity, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, insulin resistance, type 2 diabetes, and cardiovascular diseases. And also, there is difference in the lipoprotein distribution in this viscerally obese as compared to non-obese individuals, and the lipid lipoprotein fractions are in a manner which predisposes to a atherogenic lipid profile in the form of high triglyceride, a small dense LDL, and low HDL cholesterol. So overall, because of this imbalance, or you can say saturation of expansion of adipose subcutaneous spaces, there is lipid overflow, and this kind of deposits in visceral leading to visceral adiposity and an inflammatory state with release of several adipose cytokines, which can have its own effect. Ectopic fat distribution in liver, myocardium, muscle, renal, and pancreas can lead to insulin resistance and also impaired insulin secretion, thus leading to high risk of type 2 diabetes and increased cardiometabolic risk. That is the importance of identifying this phenotype. Now, what has talked about the pathophysiology has been clearly shown in several studies. I've put up some of these studies. Now, in this particular study, they categorized patients with normal BMI into subclassification based on the body fat, and it was clearly shown that individuals with a higher body fat had higher components of metabolic syndrome, central obesity, high triglyceride, low HDL, and also high hypoglycemia and high blood pressure in both men and women. So another Sweden study with 6,000 subjects also showed a higher components of metabolic syndrome, diabetes, hypertension, dyslipidemia when these individuals were followed up, that individual with normal weight obesity were followed up. And also what they found that these individuals had a higher risk of cardiovascular mortality with a hazard ratio of 2.2%. And then these patients with normal weight obesity, again, the studies have shown that in spite of having similar BMI, those with higher body fat percent have low insulin sensitivity. And then you also have shown studies where they looked at the inflammatory markers, and it was shown that inflammatory molecules like interleukin and TNF-alpha, interleukin-1-alpha, interleukin-1-beta, interleukin-6-8, were significantly higher in patients with normal weight obesity as compared to non-obese individuals. And these markers were these markers in normal weight obesity were in between the non-obese and obese patients, again suggesting that this normal weight obesity syndrome could be a marker of early inflammatory state. Again, the study from India, which I mentioned earlier, also showed that individuals with normal weight obesity had a higher prevalence of type 2 diabetes, with odds ratio of 2.7, hypertension, odds ratio of 1.8, and higher prevalence of dyslipidemia. And then visceral adiposity, after all the other parameters in this particular study, showed that a higher visceral adiposity was the most important determinant factor in determining the risk of having two or more cardiometabolic risk factors as compared to BMI, waist circumference, and total body fat percent. So visceral adipose tissue would be a more specific indicator. So why is it important to be aware of this phenotype or diagnosing this phenotype? Because like I showed, there has been clear link with the cardiometabolic dysfunction. There are also studies which have shown that normal weight obesity itself is an independent strong predictor of cardiovascular mortality. And also because of the apparently normal appearing body habitus, and if you're only going by BMI, we might miss these phenotypes. And also the individuals themselves may not be aware of their particular phenotype being a risk factor for cardiovascular diseases and metabolic diseases. Hence, it's important that you're aware of these phenotypes. So how can we apply clinically? I think we should be, first and foremost, we should be aware of these different obesity phenotypes and not just define patients on the BMI. Of course, a higher BMI carries risk, but then patients with low BMI also look for these risk factors. Waist circumference is a very simple clinical tool which can add more information with respect to central adiposity or visceral adiposity. And then we have enough clinical data and studies showing that it's a very important tool which has shown a significant association with cardiometabolic risk factors and CV mortality. You can use body composition analysis tool, which is simple, like bioelectrical impedance or DEXA body composition, which could also be helpful. Again, it's very important to assess cardiometabolic risk factors or components of metabolic syndrome in individuals with this phenotype, and also address these risk factors to overall reduce the complications associated with these phenotypes. So I think the important take-home message is, first and foremost, that we must be aware of this phenotypes, that is normal weight obesity and metabolically obese with normal weight. And then, of course, there is a need of research on more about its prevalence, and then also about its associations, and then what are the risk factors. And of course, there is, like I said, there is no clear-cut guidelines on the diagnostic cutoffs, on how to manage these individuals. Hence, there is requirement of guidelines. Of course, we also need ethnicity-specific cutoffs to use to our specialty in clinical practice. And there's definitely need of guidelines, which is, again, ethnicity-specific. With this, I would like to end my talk, and I would be happy to take any questions. Thank you.